Hi there, everybody, and a very warm welcome back to Musically Speaking. I hope that you're all safe and well at home, and those close to you are safe and well too. Thank you for watching in such numbers over the last months and for sharing and showing such interest in hearing from some of music's most inspiring artists talk in this setting. I've been blown away by our guests, and I hope you've enjoyed the conversations too. For those of you tuning in for the first time, my name is Alexander Shelley. I'm a conductor of orchestras and I'm the music director of Canada's National Arts Centre Orchestra. And for those of you who don't know the orchestra, we are based at Canada's flagship performing arts institution, the National Arts Centre, which is situated in the nation's capital, just a few steps away from Parliament. I'm not in Ottawa. I'm speaking to you from my hometown of London in England, not Ontario, where I've been with my family since the beginning of lockdown in March. And as I say at the beginning of each of these conversations, to those members of our NAC community who are watching, the orchestra and I miss you so much, and we cannot wait to be together with you again as soon as possible, enjoying music, enjoying art, enjoying conversation and dialogue. And to everyone else who's tuning in, a very, very warm welcome. I'm so grateful that you're here with us live today. Musically Speaking is a bi-weekly hour-long live session which I welcome stars from the music world, with a particular focus on Canadian stars, to tell us about themselves, to talk about their life and art, and to field some questions from me, but also your questions. In the course of the last few weeks, I've spoken with James Ennis and Gabriela Montero and Misha Brugger-Gossman and Jan Duszewski, and we've received some really, really great questions from our live audience. So please don't be shy. Share any thoughts and questions you have for us. And my wonderful assistant, Kelly Simmons, who's producing behind the scenes, will feed everything to me. She appears as Alexander Shelley in the chat box if you're watching from my page. So please do that. I am so privileged to welcome today's guest. He's not yet 30, but he's already traveled what I find to be an extraordinary and a fascinating journey from his childhood in Fredericton, New Brunswick, through studies as a classical tenor at Dalhousie, onto creating what one could argue is almost a new musical genre, along with colleagues like Tanya Tigak and A Tribe Called Red. Through his work, and through that work, he has won the 2018 Polaris Music Prize, and in 2019 he won a Juno for the Indigenous Album of the Year. He has several times graced the stages at the NAC, including at the Governor General's Performing Arts Award in 2018, and subsequently a poignant set during the Mushkamo Festival that celebrated the opening of the NAC's Indigenous Theatre Department, which was the first in the world of its kind. And on a personal level, I find his album both brilliant and incredibly moving. In fact, my whole family loves it and are fans. He's also an inspiring voice within music, but as an activist for Indigenous voices and for LGBTQ voices. So please join me in giving a huge welcome to Jeremy Dutcher. Hi, thank you so much for being here.
I'm so happy to be here with you, Alexander. This is a real treat.
Oh, thank you. You're well, I hope, and your family as well.
Yeah, so far as I know, I could, I've been feeling good. It's really nice to be back here. As you mentioned, I guess we're two hometown boys right now.
Exactly.
You're in your hometown. Yeah, I'm in New Brunswick right now, and so to be with family at this time is what I needed. I don't know about you, but I think to keep my heart strong and in these times has been hard.
Absolutely.
So
And asking if you're well is a relative question, right? Because I, of course, meant in the sense of health, primarily the pandemic, but of course, there's many other reasons why one might feel healthy but not well, because the times we're living through are an enormous struggle. So I guess I needed more nuance in the question, but I hope that despite everything, in the broadest sense, that you feel strong and well.
Thank you. Yeah, I mean, surrounded by kin is how that has come to be. But
Yeah.
hard times, as you said, I think we're all kind of taking a hard look at these systems and things around us, and trying to ask important questions in this moment. So,
And yours, I hope in the course of the conversation to dig into that a little bit, because there are some people in the world, when you hear them speak authentically about their experiences, when they come from any particular communities and they're speaking about their community experiences as a representative, there are people who uplift you, and you're one of them, I have to say. No, I do. Through your music, and I said to you just before we came live on air that I'd spent the last week sort of deeply inside, research. I thought I knew a little bit about you, and about your music. And as I said, I've always enjoyed your album. It's extraordinary. But yeah, just digging a little bit further, I find that your message is one that's very honest and direct, but I find it very uplifting and hopeful ultimately. But that's I'd love to get into that during the course of the interview. Or conversation, let's put it that way. Where were you when this all began? Where were you?
Well, to be honest, like when it really started to come out and we started to hear trickles of what was going on, I was on tour. So basically, I'd been on tour for the last 2.5 years, maybe 3, and we were in Australia at the time. And that was so, because there was also the fires going on there too at the time, and it was a real bizarre time. So we got out and we finished our tour in LA, and then right before the border shut down, we got back to Canada. So yeah, it's been kind of like this really interesting time because like it was go for like a long time for me after putting out this record. They don't tell you that you should probably create like 2 or 3 records before you put your first one out because you never know how that one's gonna go.
You
And
have
then you'll
enough
have
time to
no.
write the next one.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Have you
So
found
this.
time during this period to write and think and
I mean, thankfully, I really tried to like not put the pressure of, this time on my creative process because I feel like that's also a recipe for, inviting in. Like, I don't know. I think there's this ethos, especially in the music industry, of like, what's next? What's your next creation? Like, personally, like I spent 5 years working on that Wollastoey Glyndŵr that record, and I'm not eager to just like, okay, well that's done. Now what? Like that I put a lot of myself into that record,
I can imagine.
and so I wanted to sit with that for a while and tour that around and show people that record. So. It was kind of, in a way, I don't want to speak about it as a blessing, but just to have that time of, it kind of felt like we were put in our rooms,
Well,
by Mother Nature to say, sit down and what now?
it's very interesting speaking to friends and colleagues. There is that. Makes sense. No one feels comfortable saying that it's a blessing because that would be the wrong language. And yet there are many people reflecting on having the time to think and be at home. And I think a lot of the activism and the movements we're seeing are because people actually have a time to think and to listen and to look at the world and maybe engage with things that have been bubbling in the back of their minds, but the humdrum of everyday life has taken over. But listen, I've been, well, two things. Firstly, let's just take a moment, perhaps, or let me ask you if we could take a moment to acknowledge the land, because that was something that we perhaps wanted to talk about as we begin our conversation.
I think it's an important site, this whole idea of a land acknowledgement, in order to talk about some bigger issues, right? So like I didn't hear a land acknowledgement until I was maybe 20, 23 or something, when I went to Vancouver, and I sat there and I heard people talk about, stewards of the land and who has been here and really walk through, talking about whose territory is what and all this kind of stuff. And I was like, oh, cool, like that felt good to be acknowledged in that space. And then as time went on, you start to hear politicians and all these people who have not given much thought to, indigenous lives before, all of a sudden feeling obligated to start everything with that acknowledgement. And, the ways in which that it gets scripted out and in the ways in which that, people are almost scared to make a mistake or something, in these conversations, I think it becomes almost an act of performativity. In that way, because what do we do when we acknowledge the land? Who do we what are we not acknowledging when we just acknowledge the land? We're actually not acknowledging the people. So, I think it's important to be discussing land rights because I think that is that's the future dialogue in this country. I think, you know, there's a lot of unanswered questions built into the system of what we call Canada that says that that is unclear, because we have both coasts of this country that are unceded, that have never been granted to either the British government, the Canadian government, or the French government. So that's New Brunswick, all the Maritimes, Quebec, BC, most of the territories. So, you know, this idea of whose land is it anyway, this is not an issue that's going away, because it's a constitutional mistake that we've made in unanswering that question. And so, you know, I think hopefully we're just, you know, we can use these acknowledgments to talk about land rights and to talk about who has been here, you know, and who is still here. Because I think, you know, when we acknowledge the land without acknowledging the people, or, you know, inviting the people in to be in that space and to take that space and to, you know, how are our institutions and how are our organizations actively engaging and building relationships with the community, rather than just saying, okay, yeah, we're, you know, we're gathered here on stolen land, and isn't that bad, you know? Well, okay, yeah, we know it's bad, but like, what are we doing, and how are we creating relationships with you know, communities that have been disenfranchised for so long and you know, moved out? That for me is the interesting conversation around land and people. So yeah, thank you so much for inviting me to have this conversation and to speak.
Well, I'm very grateful. This is what I mean about finding you somebody that I find very engaging and hopeful to listen to, because that's a clear articulation of a perspective which is enriching. Because I also, the first time I heard a land acknowledgement was when I came to Canada. It, you know, every country has a different relationship with its past, and Europe's and England's is a certain thing, and land acknowledgements, as I've experienced them in Canada, are not something that I grew up with. But any thinking person thinks about the things they say, and thinks about aspects of ritual, and asks themselves, is this just ritual for the sake of ritual, or will this engender change? And so I find the way you just put that very, very helpful, because it's important to remind people. It's not, you don't just say the words. Let's talk about what we mean when we do that. So thank you for that. And now, moving from something important and deep to just a quick fire round of questions for those audience members who don't know you so well, this will be hopefully fun and easy. So you get a veto. If you don't like them, just don't answer. But
okay, I'm here.
Okay, here we go. Mornings or evenings?
Evenings. Always.
City,
always.
Or country?
Oh, yes.
Both.
I will take both. I'm a duality person. So I think, like, I have to have my, you know, because we come from the country and from the land, and that's important. But I've become a city boy too. So.
Okay. The duality thing might be a problem, because these are all either or questions. So you might just say yes to everything.
I'll figure it out. Sorry.
So land or lake?
Land or lake? River.
Melancholy or joy?
Oh, melancholy. Melancholy.
I thought you'd say that.
Yeah, yeah, you heard that. You heard the record. You know.
It's so much more fun. Head or heart?
Heart, always.
Yeah.
Every time.
Listen or talk?
Listen. Ooh, that is exactly the medicine right now, eh?
Right.
It's just time to listen. And I think, yeah. You know, this simple wisdom of, you know, we got these ears. Mm. You know, we got these ears, two of them, and one of these.
Absolutely.
That's it.
Exactly.
I'll listen.
Travel or stay home?
I feel like that answer's changed very recently. Mm. I was actually quite tired of travel, you know. We were, and you know this, you guys tour not infrequently, you know. And, you know, I can only imagine taking a whole orchestra on tour. I just had three musicians, you know, and it was a
well,
lot.
It's funny you mentioned you're in Australia, because I was, during the research, I was looking at which clip of one of your songs to show, and I saw it was recorded in Sydney Town Hall 3 weeks before I was in Sydney Town Hall with the Sydney Symphony, and how we were in the same place. The same. I was in Australia when this all happened too. It's
Oh
so
my
funny.
gosh.
But yeah, I feel the same way. I find travel a great gift of our age that we're able to experience the world and cultures. But I've also valued the time at home. I think my answer may have changed, but.
Absolutely. And I think too, I mean, I think a lot about my ancestors and just how limited their movement has been for thousands and thousands of years. You know, we were just in our territory, and then, you know, after the creation of the reservation system or reserves, up until, you know, shockingly recently, we had to get permission to leave the reserve, and we weren't able to, like, you know, and so that kind of restriction, I think that, you know, my people have been living under for generations, is in stark contrast to the life that I get to live right now. So,
Right.
you know, I think it's such an immense privilege and gift that I get to see so much of this world. And then too, to like, it's been amazing to go out there, and because Indigenous people are everywhere, you know, it's like in every corner of the planet, there's people that are in conversation with the land. And, you know, getting to go out and meet, you know, Indigenous people from Scandinavia or Indigenous people from Asia, or, you know, we all share this struggle, you know, we all share these very similar stories and yet very specific in our own context. So
Right. I was on tour in South Africa earlier this year, and a colleague that I was working with down there was describing how his parents during apartheid had the same thing. They couldn't leave their town after a certain time of night. You know, this is 40 years ago. Anyway, okay, back to these questions.
these easy
Exactly.
questions. Sorry.
Cook or be cooked for?
Ooh.
So cook for others or be cooked
No,
for by others?
my stomach is the way to my heart, so absolutely be cooked for. But I've recently taken up the culinary charge, so I've been cooking a lot more lately too. So, you know, who knows?
Good.
That answer could be different next month.
Okay. Do you save or spend?
Save. Oh, ooh. It depends on the day, I guess. But I think, yeah, I think the save is my go-to.
Okay. I'm gonna ask you, I'm gonna quote a line from Pink Floyd. I asked Gabriela Montero, the pianist and activist Venezuelan, a few weeks ago, the Pink Floyd line, would you rather be a walk-on part in the war or a lead role in a cage? And I'll
Could you
ask
do
you,
one more? Could you do one more
is
time?
oh, you gotta know you're Pink Floyd, man. You're a
I don't. I'm so
songwriter.
sorry.
Okay. I'm sure.
I
Would
was
you
born in
rather
the
have
90s, Alexander. I'm
I
so
know.
thankful. Okay,
Would you
okay,
rather have
okay.
a walk-on part in the war or a lead role in the cage? In a cage. You get
No.
the no.
Okay, so yeah, I do get it.
It's hard though.
I'm terribly opposed to war metaphors,
I apologize.
but enough with the cages. The cages gotta
Yeah.
stop. Cages are done. So I would rather be part of a resistance than part of a system that chooses to capture people.
Great. If you weren't a musician, what would your dream job be?
A linguist.
Ah, okay.
Yeah,
That
I
makes
think.
sense. Yeah.
You know, I think, yeah, I've been so fascinated by language my entire life. And it's, you know, something that came into focus, you know, through the creation of this album and really understanding that it was important for us to have Indigenous language music in the world. You know, outside of a very few people in this country, there had been, you know, not a lot of music that is played on the radio in our language. And so, for me, understanding that dearth and what was not there became my sort of call to like what I wanted to see in the world. So, yeah, I think linguist or no, that might be it. That might just be
Okay.
it.
Well, I have to just, these are supposed to be quick discussion points, but I lived for nearly 20 years in Germany, and German became like a second mother tongue to me. And one of the things, and I've always enjoyed languages too, one of the things that fascinates me is how the mode of thinking, the actual construction of thought, and through that, perception of the world changes depending on the language you speak, which has quite fundamental effects then on the world. And it's such an important thing to bear in mind that language, to a degree, defines, of course, thought and thought processes. And that's another reason to try and empathize with that aspect of people's cultures and to understand
it. It almost sounds like cuckoo bananas for people that don't, that might be monolingual, because right. It's like understanding that we are who we are based on our language that we speak, and we think the way that we do based on the language that we inherited.
And even the sentence construction. So you know, where you place a verb, how complex sentence. I find myself in English sometimes creating sentences that are stupid, that they don't make any sense, because I've sort of like started in a German.
It's perfect in German, though. Yeah. Auf Deutsch?
Exactly.
You know, and it's Germans. It's kind of funny because like English and German, they're not dissimilar. And yet they have these very like specific, I think it's called polymorphic, mm-hmm. how they sort of have these building blocks in German where you can put an idea together based on, you know, several smaller chunks of words.
Right.
And it becomes this big, long, poetic one, you know, word that's that long.
Yeah, yeah.
Our languages have a very similar, we have a very similar structure to that. Actually,
really?
Yeah, of this polymorphic, you know, it's the word order is completely different, but
right.
it's the ways that we build the our complex words are very similar to German.
Fantastic. Okay, if you could meet anyone in history, who would it be? And talk to them.
Oh my God. I think this past year I met three of my absolute icons and people that. But you're asking dead or alive, right? So
kind of not with us anymore.
Right. I think I'd want to sit down with somebody like Nina Simone. She I think her, I guess a singer, just like her voice alone is like one of the most unique voices that has ever been heard. But then her story, you know, as an activist, and her story as, you know, coming out of this classical tradition and, you know, because of, you know, circumstance, because of racism and so many things, she sort of veered off into create this kind of music of her own, really make this own kind of genre of like, it's not really, and she described it as, it's not jazz. I don't play jazz music. I play black classical music.
That's beautiful. Yeah.
The idea of that kind of like,
yeah, yeah.
You know, and it blew my, like, it started me to thinking, you know, what does indigenous classical music sound like?
Right.
You've
just written the perfect segue, because I want to get exactly into that. But before we do that, for those viewers who don't yet know your album, there's this beautiful clip that The National put together when I think the album was being released. And I'd love, Kelly, if you would be so kind behind the scenes there to run the clip from The National, just to give our audience an introduction to the album, because then let's get into the question of indigenous classical music, what that would look like.
Great.
Okay, Kelly.
When I came into a better understanding of my language, Wolustigwe, I started to understand my place in the world a little bit better and started to relate to the world around me differently. And so that's why it was important for me to do this album in my language, because there's less than 100 fluent speakers left. I think it's important for people to understand a true history and what has actually happened and what continues to happen in this country around the systematic devaluing of indigenous languages and culture.
as soon as I came to understand a little more about my mother's journey with the language, she went into the day schools at a very young age when she was 6 years old, and you weren't allowed to speak your language there. In fact, you were physically punished, you were beaten if you did. You know, coming to understand that it wasn't safe for her to speak her language when she was young. And her mother, my grandmother, said, you know, it's better if you don't know the language, and so we're just not gonna speak it to you. Intergenerational effects of that shame around language and culture are clear. So that's why I turned to the archive. So when I first got to hear these voices, that word for me was a profoundly transformational moment in my life. And it connected me all the way up and down to those who have gone before and those who have yet to come. At first, I would listen over and over again. I would start to sketch where the melody was going. And then finally, after that, I could put some notes to it. I sort of took those notes with me and went home and started to sit at my piano. And to create arrangements and worlds around each of these melodies. And let those melodies guide my process. I was very, very fortunate, you know, to have a music education and to be able to, you know, to transcribe what I was hearing. It was a process of deep listening, of really trying to sit there with these headphones and hear what these voices had to tell me. Getting to witness the life in these recordings, getting to hear my ancestors laugh, tell stories, sing songs, you know, dance. You can hear them dancing. This is incredible to me. You know, this was collected in the early 1900s, and it's been living in the museum ever since. You know, as a young person, I didn't know about this collection and these songs, and so for me, I felt such a responsibility to go and share that with other young people. So when you look at the album cover, you can see wax cylinders on the floor, which were what these were collected on, using the phonograph machine in the middle there. And I'm seated in the chair with this traditional jacket on. I wanted to represent that time that these songs were collected. And so that was sort of where this whole album kind of came from, was that impetus to say, I've witnessed this beautiful thing, these old voices, and it's not doing any good sitting on a shelf collecting dust. This project allowed me to do was like sit down with my mother and my elders in my community and ask them about their lives and say, what was your experience of music growing up? What did your community sound like, you know, growing up? For me, starting, you know, this record, it's called, with a death chant, Mejanud, was a very clear statement to me that even though a lot of narratives get applied to our languages, especially Wolastoqe, you know, because there's so few speakers left, a lot of people say, oh, it's a dying language, you know? I don't believe that to be true. Nothing ever died, you know? Our dances and our songs and our language, they just had to go away for a bit, for safekeeping. And our elders tell us that it's time. It's time to take it all out, and it all needs to come out. And it won't be until then that we're going to be able to come to understand each other.
Tahu.
It's a beautifully put together a clip, I find, and it gives a succinct and sort of moving insight into how you went about creating the album. And I find I can never quite put my finger on what it is that moves me about your music, because I think there's so many aspects. But one of them is that as a child of musicians, I think that the process of listening to a previous generation, in my case, my parents, but then, really listening and not internalizing just their words, but their way of making music, their way of, in this case, singing, in my parents' case, their way of playing the piano, their rhythm, their timbre, it opens, and this is, I guess, why we're musicians, but it opens a gate to a far deeper part of the soul, and for me, a far truer part of who they are than the words they speak. And I think I find both my parents way more articulate in music than when they speak. But I think that's one of the reasons that your music moves me so deeply, because I so deeply hope that I could pass something like that on to my son, that he can really listen when I make music and really internalize it. So thank you for that. But tell me, with that in mind, how did it feel when you heard one of those wax cylinders for the first time?
Yeah, I mean, that's the kind of thing that is almost like trying to describe air, but it's something you'll never forget too, right? Like it was one of the most, I don't know if you've ever experienced, again, it sounds like cuckoo bananas. I don't know if you've ever experienced this in your life, but there's these moments, and it's happened to me a couple times now, but of just, I guess, like a totally transcendental moment of everything else outside of that physical space, that room that you're seeing, is lifted. And there's a deep sense of presence. So when, and Mejinud, that I think that last song that was on that clip was the first melody that I heard. And, I forgot that I said that in this clip, but, the fact that you can hear them dancing, you can hear them laughing, you can hear, it's really like a snapshot. It's so much more than just an audio recording. It's really like a time capsule. So I think that feeling I can best describe as like transcendental or like otherworldly, because it just like it in an instant, I kind of knew what needed to happen, that it couldn't live there anymore, that this knowledge and these songs and these dances have been so disconnected from our people, and that time was done. We lived through that period, we survived that period, we are still singing, we're still dancing, and yet there's so much that had been collected that needs to come back to the people. So it was this, this sense of like, whoa, mind blown, and then also a sense of like, okay, let's go. Like, I know what needs to be done.
And the online there are a few different versions of Mejnun, and we're going to play one of the clips later. It's actually the music video, and I was very close to putting on the live one. You did one for CBC First Play, and I was like, up until the last minute, I thought, let's do that one because it's beautiful. Every version of it takes my breath away. The reason I decided not to, though, if it's okay with you, is that you start that one off right at the piano. You play the chord and you start singing, which is stunning. But I find, well, in fact, I'm sorry, you do that in the music video too. But that moment where you segue across into the voice, the original wax cylinder, and then come back again, it is that in music, it's very rare to experience that tangible connection with the past. I don't think I've ever heard it done in that way, where someone has taken a recording of an ancestor. I mean, even just someone that you respected from the past, and then sung alongside them, and the harmonization—that's the other thing, because, and it's something I wanted to understand from you is, I mean, I love doing that. I think every musician loves doing that. You take a melody, and you say, "How can I change the appearance of that melody through harmony?" And it's amazing for non-musicians, I think, how much you can change the effect of a melody by reharmonizing. But your choice of harmonies there, it's like a musical walking hand in hand, but it's not looking back into the past and sort of reminiscing. It's saying, I'm here now. It's a very,
Walking together, yeah.
yeah, it really, I think it's astonishing how you achieved what I believe you set out to achieve. And I think about that Polaris Music Prize, and somebody really deserving that prize, in that they have a vision of something that is unique and they make it happen. There could have been no more deserving winner that year. I'm sure there were many brilliant candidates, but anyway, what I wanted to know is, did you grow up speaking the language, or did you part of the process learning it?
Yeah, so like I mentioned in that video, you know, it's my mother's first language, and she spoke it up until about 6 years old as the only language that she knew. Upon which then she went into the Indian day schools. So it's sort of like the residential schools, but that just kind of shifted.
I see.
You know, it became, you know, like, okay, it's not a boarding school because you go home at night, but it's still religious instruction. You're still being called a heathen every day by these Catholic nuns. And, you know, it's like, it's the same system of a different name. So she went into this school system and, you know, basically, I never say she lost her language because I don't think that's true. I don't think you ever lose your first language. But you know, it really put a veil or a silence on, I think, her comfortability to speak. And so when we were growing up, you know, I would often hear, you know, her talk to her mother or her aunts. And it was around us, you know, we heard it, but, you know, it was not, you know, our everyday language. So, you know, we had the, you know, come here, do this, do that, all these, you know, sort of command phrases. But it wasn't until, you know, I started to, you know, think about what was missing and think about what was lost and think about the music that, you know, I wanted to see in the canon, in out there in the world, that I knew that it was the language that was the key to that. And right. So that took me on a journey of really, and it's tough too, because, like, what is this idea of fluency? You know, it's like, it's not an end point, you know, it's a spectrum and it's a journey. Right. And so I think for me, and it's probably easier to obtain or have a metric or scale of something in a language like German, where it's like, there's very much a canon of literature, you know, there's been a written language for a very long time and all this kind of stuff. We don't have any of that. So, you know, up until 20 years ago, we didn't even have a written language. You know, well, so it's all very new.
I wanted to ask your perspective on it. I know that people could find this in other interviews with you, but the importance of music as a vessel for wisdom and law and everything in an oral tradition. Can you just speak to that for a moment? Because it is so fundamental, right?
Right. And it really, like, a song becomes a different thing than just a pretty melody when we start to look at it in the context of indigenous knowledge form, because, you know, we didn't have those, you know, written documents of this is the law, or like, this is how we are to live our lives. This is how we pass on our values to our kids through stories, whatever, right? We had that, but in a less maybe tangible way, in a way of saying that, like, we sit amongst our elders, we sit with the knowledgeable ones, and they give it on to us. They sing to us. They give us those songs. They give us those dances, those laws. And really, that is what that's doing. Those songs become a form of law in keeping our nation and our minds strong. So,
you're just, you know, ruminating on that idea, particularly over the last few years, as Canadian culture has become very much, you know, and I mean that in its wider sense, encompassing all the cultures that we, you know, as an international one would think of or come to mind when one thinks of Canada. My little boy is a Canadian, by the way. He was born there. So it's kind of important that I figure some of this stuff out. But yeah. I you can take any word, but thinking of the word truth, which is an enigmatic word, and in many contexts, it's hard to pin down and it can be malleable. When I think of oral traditions, I think about a great beauty that I find in there of a generation retelling, and through the retelling potentially reframing or refocusing truths and wisdoms for a new generation as context changes. And in the right hands or in the right mouths, there is an enormous sophistication to that process. Yeah. And, you know, psychologists describe, I think, it as narrative identity, through narrative identity, I mean, that's used for lots of different things, but you can create a more sophisticated awareness of who you are. And if you're relating back to scripts that are from the 17th, the 16th, and the 15th century that were written for their time, you can come away with really the wrong impression sometimes. So I think there's a huge and enormous beauty to it. But I was wondering whether you have sensed that as those oral traditions coexist with written traditions that now exist, but also with our new oral tradition, which is social media, which is nuts, right? Because that is people just like telling their stories in their way. How do you think the oral traditions that you're referring to are faring?
I mean, it's inevitably changed. I think the landscape in which that we are talking about these conversations is so fundamentally different than just one generation ago, right? Like the ways in which even just like something like indigenous connectivity across nations. So like, you know, I flip on my social media now, and I'm connected with, you know, community leaders from Cree community out west, or, you know, Wet'suwet'en people in BC, or, you know, Anishinaabe people in Northern Ontario. You know, all of these amazing connectivities now are existing where we are having conversations between ourselves now that never were possible before. And I think that will be transformative. I think it will change how we tell our stories. It will change so much. And I think we're at this like amazing point right now where we've been talking to each other for like a generation now in a way that was not possible before. And I think those kind of relationships are going to create a whole new generation of young Indigenous people that are extremely educated, are highly connected with other Indigenous activists, and are really switched on right now because we are also watching. You know, I think what was so funny about the colonial project was that the whole time the British were just watching us and they didn't think we were watching them too. And there's this idea, you know, from the ship and the shore, is that, you know, the history of Indigenous people for a really long time has been told by the ship.
Right.
You know, and I think what we're seeing now is that those stories from the shore are now coming out, and how we view this whole situation. Because for a long time, like, our stories weren't told by us. Even like, think about every Indian in every movie, like, that is most, first of all, most of them were Italians. Second, you know, the directors, there were no, you know, sensitivity people on that crew to, right, you know, speak about Native people in a respectful way, you know? And so I think, you know, a lot of what non-Indigenous people think about Indigenous issues or Indigenous people comes from outside of us. It comes from the media. It comes from people that don't really know our story. And so what we're seeing now, and I think it's really an important transformation, is that we are taking the reins of our own narrative, and we are getting to tell our own stories for the first time, and, you know, and doing it in our languages, and not having to translate necessarily. You know, I didn't provide a single translation for this work, and there was something important in that. It wasn't just because I forgot, you know. It was because I wanted to specifically direct the conversation that I wanted to have to my community, to let them know that all of this work that I did to go into the archives, to collect these songs, to get it, that work was not for the consumption of a non-Indigenous Canadian audience. That was for my community specifically. Mm-hmm. And, you know, everyone's invited around that table or around that fire to witness. But there has to be an acknowledgement that this is a conversation between myself and my community.
Beautiful.
And I think when we can start to hear people's stories more, this is how, and that's why I'm so excited about, you know, what's going on at the NAC with the Indigenous theater program, because once people see our stories, like our real stories from our community, from our perspective, I think that is going to go so much further to change hearts and minds than, you know, any politician or any piece of policy.
And Kevin Loring and Laurie Marchand, they went with the phrase for the season of our stories are our medicine, which is also a beautiful concept, and it sort of has infused everything that every story they told. It's a tragedy that the first season of Indigenous theatre has been cut short like this.
Isn't that it, eh?
And, you know, I think for all of the performing artists who are at the NAC, it's for all performing artists around the world, it's a sad moment. But my heart particularly goes out to my friends and colleagues here from Indigenous theatre, because they had such an incredible season already. And, you know, but you mentioned community, and you mentioned the community of Indigenous peoples across the country and the communication that you're in now with one another. And that's another nice segue. We've only actually got 12 more minutes, and you were going to perform something for us. Maybe we can go on a couple more minutes, but I'd love to segue then into your song, the music video for Mejinod. Am I pronouncing that correctly, Mejinod? I've tried to...
Well, I'll be honest with you. I think, like, even in that CBC national piece, I was pronouncing it wrong.
Oh,
imagine. So my mother had to call me and correct me. She said, honey, you're not saying that right. And it's very important to say it right too, because there's a word that's very close that is meaning something totally
okay.
different.
Yeah.
So I was saying Mejinod, which is speaking about somebody who's giving unwanted touching.
Oh, yeah, I got that from you.
Yeah, I know. I'll take full responsibility. Okay. But the way to pronounce this word is Mejinod.
Okay.
So it's called a death chant. Yeah.
Okay. Kelly, would you be kind enough to roll a clip of Mejinod?
Oh,
Am I muted? Can you hear me okay?
I can hear you, yeah.
I can't with that song. It's so haunting, it's so moving. And like I mentioned, I was looking at the different versions online, and I can only recommend to our audience that you go out and listen to them all, because each one of them is different and speaks to Jeremy's talents. In the comments sections, a lot of people, and from lots of different backgrounds, say that they are brought to tears by that song, and I feel absolutely the same way. And I found that the video also, of course, is very moving and very intelligent. This starting with the empty stage and ending with both the baby, the symbol of the future, but also this celebration of Indigenous talent on stage, because that's what you mentioned, being in connection with one another. And you see A Tribe Called Red and Alanis Obamsawin, and it was an extraordinary idea. And then I was reading your statement that you put out with that video, which, and each paragraph was brilliant, but one of them just stood out, which was, drawing our circles wide, we make our gathering places radically inclusive, relying on all gifts and abilities to make our presence and positions known. And that's what I mean about you having an uplifting vision of diversity. It's bringing in those voices and showing in that video, as you did, how everything can complement one another. So how did you come to that finished article? Did you know the artists, all of them, already, or were some of them new relationships?
Well, I had known of all of their work. And so I knew a couple of them personally, just as you know, friends in the Indigenous art world. But I mean, there's some people that I asked to be a part of that video that I never thought
really
would, you know, but he's just little old me, right? Like, you know, it's my first anything. I just, you know, I didn't
Did
have much
of a... Did you just get on the blower and say, this is what I'm doing, what do you think?
Kind of, yeah. Oh, cool. And, you know, I think, you know, it didn't all work out. But who we got around the table, I think I'm just so blown away. And here's the thing, like, I think about all of those people around that table as constellations, right? Because they are representative for their community, and behind them stands, you know, a myriad of artists and people that are creating, and a lineage of so much. And we tried to get a really wide representation of Indigenous, the variety of Indigenous people making all kinds of work. So, you know, we had, you know, filmmakers like Alanis, who is such a, oh my God.
She's extraordinary.
And then, you know, somebody like a young filmmaker like Asiniak, who's from the north, or, you know, Emma, who's the first person at that table. She's from my community, you know, sitting right beside A Tribe Called Red. And, you know, there's so many, just so many different voices, people that I had been inspired by in my coming up, and, you know, who lit the way for me. You know, I don't exist without, you know, A Tribe Called Red. I don't exist without Buffy St. Marie. I don't exist without all of these people that have gone before and have made it possible for, you know, us to have this conversation, for people to even consider Indigenous music as something they want to listen to. You know, that wasn't the case just one generation ago. You know, I think about my mother and her experience with race in this country, and, you know, what I'm doing today is not, it just wouldn't happen. So I you know, give gratitude every day for that, because I'm able to take up space and to have conversations that, you know, just one generation ago there was no space. Yeah. So I think I'm encouraged by that. I think that, you know, kids growing up, you know, we had only a couple people in the dominant
you know, in the media, who were indigenous, you know, people like Buffy, who were taking up so much space in the way of, you know, having those really important conversations. And, you know, when there was nobody else in the room, you know, when she was the only one. Thankfully, now we've come to a space where, you know, there, you know, I can go to a music festival and I'm finally not the only indigenous artist there. You know, because what happens when we only have such a limited view of what indigenous music is? You know, I've been to, you know, I've talked to audiences after shows and they said, well, you know, your music doesn't sound very indigenous. Well, what does that mean, right? Like, what were you expecting?
Right.
You know, were you just expecting me to get up and sing with my drum?
Yeah.
Are you surprised that I play the piano? You know, it's like, you know, it's all of these things and breaking down expectations of what people, who people think we are, and letting them know that we are modern. We are here today, and we are creating from our own perspective.
And there are probably as many iterations and perspectives on indigeneity as there are indigenous people, because each person has different perspective. And so the more one can hear and listen and learn, the better also one can comprehend that universe that is that experience. So listen, I have literally like 30 more questions that I wanted to unpick with you. And so I hope that one day we can have the opportunity to do something similar again, because I do, you know, you've mentioned there several leaders in the arts field in the indigenous world. But they're above and beyond the indigenous world. They're just leaders in the arts field, and they're voices that are fascinating, that inspire me. But yours is most definitely one that I find in so many ways, but starting with the music, inspirational. So thank you for having the time with us today. And I believe you're going to gift us with some music as we leave. And afterwards, I have one more chance to say thank you to you.
Okay, yeah, I hope I can. You know, and I think, you know, it's important for me and my work to highlight, you know, indigenous excellence, as we were talking about in that video. But, you know, I think I want to take a moment to honor those indigenous people that don't have the opportunity of excellence, don't even have a way in the door. You know, people like Chantel Moore or Rodney Levi, two indigenous people in the province of New Brunswick, who in the span of 8 days were murdered by police officers. And so I think, you know, as beautiful as it is to lift up excellence, there's also so much, there's indigenous life is not always honored if it's not excellent, you know? And well, so
let's just take the extra few minutes, if you don't mind. I wanted to ask you a question that, I don't want to put you on the spot, but I'd be so interested to hear, with as a man with a powerful voice, literally and figuratively, what do you think is the single greatest obstacle standing in the way of an equitable and respectful nation-to-nation relationship in Canada?
Ooh, well...
Sorry, just to throw that
just
one
a small question to end. What is standing in the way? I think it's, you know, as I've been talking, you know, in this time, it's kind of that they don't know us, that our stories have not been told in an honest and truthful way. They've been abstracted and they've been taken from us. You know, you don't have to look too much further than any museum in the country to know that, like, you know, our objects, our stories, our songs have been harvested. And so I think what is important right now is to listen. I think for our allies and our non-Indigenous people that really want to stand with us, you know, I think it's important to use your voice and get loud. But fundamentally, I think there's a lot of unlearning that needs to happen around you know, all these systems that we've inherited. None of us built them, you know. We support them and we inherit them. And you know, even the institution, like the site of classical music, you know, like whose classic is that? You know, I've heard this term that, you know, people are starting to use Western art music. And I kind of like that because it decentralizes a European identity in when we talk about classical music, because, you know, what's to say that, you know, what I created is not in that genre? You know, absolutely, it's indigenous classical music, all the same, right? So,
I know it's not the point, but I'm not a fan of that term anyway, because when people hear the word classical music, again, the associations that your average person has on the street is of wigs and puff powdered faces. And of course, it's in itself is 500 years of history in music from all over the globe. So I agree, it's an imperfect term at the best of times.
You know, and things like world music, you know, like
right.
All music is music in the world. Like, why are we quantifying that with when, God, having to go and play a world music festival as an indigenous person on your own land is like just kind of a funny little thing. But, you know, so much to say that, like, I think the powerful tool right now that we have is our ears. And, you know, people of color, indigenous communities are standing up and speaking their truth right now. And I think we're invited, all of us. I think, you know, I don't pretend to know everything about Black struggle in this country. I don't know nothing about that. You know, so I listen to people like Misha. I listen to people, you know, who have that lived experience and are really standing up and speaking about that. And I think that's what we're all called to do in this moment. And rather than, you know, try to be argumentative about it or fight it or say, well, it can't be that bad. You know, it's like, just believe people. You know, they're coming to you with their honest truth and their tale. And I think the more that we make space for other voices, you know, it comes back to diversity too, of thought, you know, and making space for all different kinds of voices to come to the table and share. And that might make us uncomfortable. It might make us question, you know, the way that we've done things for, you know, 30 years. But I think at the end of the day, that's good. It's generative change, you know. So I'm going to sing about it, and I'm going to lift up a healing chant to Chantel Moore and Rodney Levi, whose lives were ended far too short. And this is called a Snake Medicine Song. And it was brought by Elder Maggie Paul, who's a very dear mentor of mine. So I'll be playing it. I don't have a piano today, unfortunately, but I do have this djimok, which is a traditional instrument here on the East Coast. And it kind of has an interesting history too. You know, up until 1951, our songs and our gatherings and our ceremonies were illegal here in Canada. And so this instrument came out of a time when, you know, our people, of course, all people make music everywhere, you know? And that doesn't stop just because a government tells you to. And so we were making music the whole time. But instead, you know, we had this system of Indian agents who were essentially government officials who lived on the reserve and watched the people to make sure, you know, and so they would sometimes come out and bust the party, bust the singing, you know, and our people, and they would destroy our instruments and our objects and all this kind of stuff. So we got tired of that. And we said, we don't want to lose our drums anymore. And so we came up with this instrument. And so when you see people coming into the fire,
So
this is a survival tool, and this kept our songs alive. And so and it doesn't really sound like a drum, it doesn't really sound like a rattle, but it's got its own vibe. And this is ash, it's ash tree, and these you pound it really hard and then it splits.
I will give you full disclosure, on one of our several trips to Eskasoni, to the community there, I spent about an hour and a half trying to make one of those things. And the guy showing me how to make it spent about 30 seconds doing it. I was a sweaty mess trying to... So it's incredible watching them being made by someone, I mean, like everything, who can do it. But I was hopeless at it. But yeah. Ash, you can do that to it if you know what you're doing.
You can do anything. Okay, so I'm gonna perform this snake medicine song. Okay, I'll be right back. Yeah.
Thank you, Jeremy. You're so generous to give us that. And thank you from the bottom of my heart and on behalf of our viewers for being with us today as well, and for sharing your typical erudite thoughts on everything and your kindness and your generosity. And I know, you know, your tour was cut short, and even though you've already achieved so much, it's still kind of the beginning of your journey. And I know the journey is going to continue to be extraordinary. I wish you every success.
And our paths will cross, I think, sooner than later. So it was a pleasure to chat.
I believe that. Thank you, Jeremy. And you can get Jeremy's album. It's on all platforms. There's a ton of incredible material online as well to enjoy and celebrate if you want to find out more about this amazing man. A big thank you to Canada Perform sponsors who've made the platform such an important and a supportive space for so many Canadian artists. They are the National Arts Centre, Facebook, Slate Music, Sirius XM Canada, and RBC Foundation. I'll be back at the same time, so that's noon Eastern, 5:30 in London, England, where I am at 9:30 a.m. in Vancouver on July 2nd, when I'll be speaking with Her Excellency Julie Payette, the Governor General of Canada, who is also, as you can imagine, an extraordinary person, an engineer, a scientist, an astronaut, but also a great music lover and dedicated choral singer who has bolstered the ranks of our choirs in Ottawa since her term began. Please do check the NAC website, nac-cna.ca, where there is a great content from our musicians that they upload on a daily basis, their lunch breaks. You can really stay in contact with them there, and they're amazing. You can sign up for free weekly symphony concerts from our archives. That's all available on the NAC website. Just please check it out. And if you've enjoyed this, do follow me here on Facebook, Alexander Shelley Conductor, on Instagram, which is Alexander underscore Shelley, or on Twitter, which is at Shelley Conduct. And, you know, when I'm doing things like this, I try to keep people informed so you can tune in. Most importantly, please look after one another, stay safe, and let's hope that we can see each other in person very soon, ideally in a concert hall with some beautiful music. Thank you for tuning in, and see you again in 2 weeks.